বাট জাস্ট কুইক রিক্যাপ, আমি একটু ইকুয়েশন গুলো লিখি যেটা আমাদের গ্রাফ সলভিং এর জন্য লাগবে। খেয়াল করি, ফার্স্ট অফ অল দ্য ইকুয়েশন দ্যাট উই হ্যাভ ইজ দ্যাট গ্র্যাভিটেশনাল ফোর্স ইজ গিভেন বাই এফ ইকুয়ালস টু জি mm by r square. This is the basic formula for gravitational force between two objects of masses m and m. Gravitational field strength of a mass is given by gm by r square, where m is the object which is creating the gravitational field, r is the distance at which the gravitational field strength is measured. Gravitational potential is given by minus gm by r. Gravitational potential is defined as the amount of work required to move an object from infinite distance to any point of a gravitational field, because getting closer to an object in that process, the gravitational field itself does the work. That's why the work done is negative. That's why potential is defined to be zero at infinite distance. The closer you get from infinite distance to an object, the potential slowly becomes less. So less from zero means negative. That's why we have a default negative sign in front of the potential sign. These are three basic equations for the gravitational situation. However, we've seen some additional equations for our purpose. One is that for a satellite movement, the orbital velocity of a satellite is given by v equals to root over of gm by r. Was there two? No, there was not two. This is the gravitational, this is the orbital speed for a satellite. For the orbital equation, what we've also seen that t square is proportional to r cube. There is a certain equation that relate to this. This proportionality is called Kepler's law. যে ইকুয়েশন থেকে এই প্রশ্নটি আসছে সেই ইকুয়েশনটা হচ্ছে অনেকটা এরকম, টি স্কয়ার ইকুয়ালস টু ফোর পাই স্কয়ার ডিভাইড বাই জি এম আর কিউব। আই থিঙ্ক দিস ওয়াজ দ্য ইকুয়েশন। আই জাস্ট হ্যাভ এ লুক, কুইক লুক। Satellite. There is a satellite. R cube is true. ঠিক আছে, what I wrote is the reverse version of this one, but it's okay. So, and also the other equation that we've seen, that for the escape velocity for any object is given by root over of 2gm by r. In this case, r would represent the radius of the planet. Another set of equation that is important is that the calculation for GPE change, delta GPE, should be calculated by the mass that we are moving within the gravitational field multiplied by the gravitational potential change. So delta phi, which should always be m into phi of the final position minus phi of the initial position. এই কটা ইকুয়েশন আমরা আপ সো ফার দেখছি এবং এগুলো নিয়ে আমরা কিছু কথাবার্তা বলছি। উই ডিড সাম ডিসকাশনস অ্যাবাউট দোজ। টুডেস ক্লাস উই গোনা ফার্স্ট ট্রাই টু গো ফর দ্য গ্রাফস দ্যাট রিলেট টু দিস সিনারিও। অ্যান্ড ফার্স্ট অফ অল টু আন্ডারস্ট্যান্ড দ্য গ্রাফস উই হ্যাভ টু টেক ইন টু অ্যাকাউন্ট দ্যাট হোয়াট কাইন্ড অফ অবজেক্ট অ্যান্ড হোয়াট কাইন্ড অফ ভ্যারিয়েবল আর উই কনসিডারিং। দ্য ভেরি ফার্স্ট থিং টু রিমেম্বার ইজ দ্যাট গ্র্যাভিটেশনাল ফিল্ড স্ট্রেংথ ইজ বাই ডেফিনেশন ডিফাইন্ড অ্যাজ for gravitational force divided by the mass of the object. So this is given by Newton per kg. So gravitational field strength is a vector quantity. This is very, very important for you to remember. Whereas gravitational potential is given by some amount of work done divided by the mass, amount of work required or amount of energy spent to bring unit mass from infinite distance to any point of the gravitational field is defined as the potential of that point. So it is work done per mass. Work is a scalar quantity, mass is also a scalar quantity. So by virtue, this is a scalar quantity. This is very, very important. Why am I telling you this? One of the important bit that you have to understand, if you're ever trying to go for the calculation of gravitational field strength for two objects simultaneously, let's say here you have an object let's say this is an object which is a mass of m1, and here you have another object. Here you have an object of, let's say, m2. I'm going to write, or maybe we should write capital M, small m is also good. Capital M, and let's say the other object is small m. And let's say the line that joins their centers is given by this line. Gravitational force is going to work this way. Gravitational force being the attractive force, it will always work towards the object, which means if you place a test mass somewhere over here of, let's say, 1 kg, both of these objects are going to pull this object towards themselves. If you are closer to the big mass, this one's attraction is going to be stronger. If you're closer to the strong mass, this one's attraction might be small, might be stronger, but that is also dependent on how far is your test object from the considered mass. Because of the gravitational equation, its gravitational force is directly proportional to the inverse squared of the distance. So these two forces are going to work in opposite direction. So whenever you're trying to find out the gravitational field strength, you might have to actually subtract the two vectors. That's one property. The other property is that if you're trying to calculate the gravitational potential for considering, let's say, if we want to bring an object from infinite distance to this location, let's say I'm going to use a different color. Let's say this is infinite distance. Here is infinite distance. Figure not drawn to scale, obviously. Let's say a 1 kg object is located right over here, and you want to bring this object somewhere in between this line. Now, if you wonder why you in between this line, why not anywhere else? We could have bring it anywhere else around these two planets or two celestial objects. For the time being, we're only considering how much energy would be required or how much gravitational field strength would be there for an object being placed exactly at the middle for the adjoining line of the two masses. That's the simpler case. We could go for any other point, but in those cases, we'd have to go for some sort of trigonometric manipulation, or we might have to use the triangle rule of vector addition for the case of a vector quantity. So to avoid simplicity as per your syllabus requires for your level A2 level, we're going to consider the object to be placed at this position. Now, what is important that if you're trying to bring an object close to somewhere in between the two masses of 1 kg object from infinite distance to this point, the potential of this point can be calculated by basically summing the potential of both of these objects. For example, at this location, the potential produced by this object is given by, let's say, gm divided by minus, let's say this distance is r of capital M, this distance is r of small m. So this is given by this. This is the potential produced by the big mass. And the potential produced by the small mass can be given by minus gm divided by r of the from the small m. These are the two individual value of the potentials of this location for individual masses. If you're trying to find out the total potential, you simply add these two numbers, and that way you get the total potential of the combined masses. Because these are scalar quantities, you don't have to bother for direction. You just add these two numbers and you're good to go. So we're going to see about the combination of these type of forces in much detail for the upcoming part. We are going to start discussing about the graph problems for individual objects. So first, we're going to set up a scenario. Let's say here we have a planet of mass capital M, and this is the center, and this is an infinitely long assumed line through which we're going to move some object of mass 1 kg. And we're going to draw up two graphs, so I'm going to draw a single line. So we are trying to plot two different variables over here in two different graphs. One is G versus R, the other one is phi versus R. This is gravitational field strength over distance. How is this going to change? And this is gravitational potential versus the distance. What do we need to understand that the mass of this whole object is, in this case, is actually it's not a particle. It's a spherical object of, let's say, uniform density. Assuming that the radius of this planet is R, so which means from the center to up to this much part, let's have a distance of capital R represent the radius of the planet. the gravitational field strength. So before I show you this part, let me just show you the possible shape for a point mass. Then I'm going to get back to this part and add this complexity of circular mass. So I'm going to keep this figure right over there. So let it be there. I'm just going to draw it over here. If we have a point mass in a certain location, let's say we have a point mass. Point mass means it only has mass, measurable mass, significant measurable mass, but it doesn't have any dimension. So it doesn't have any volume. Let's say the mass of this object is M. And if we are trying to draw those two graphs of G and phi, I am intentionally drawing the G graph to be on the first quadrant and intentionally drawing the phi graph on the fourth quadrant because I know that phi is going to be a negative value for all of my graph plotting, whereas G is going to be positive for my graph plotting because I'm talking about attraction. And in this case, for this G to be positive, we have to understand that along this line, we can place any test object of, let's say, 1 kg mass to measure the gravitational field strength. And the attraction of this mass is going to be always work towards left. No matter where you place another 1 kg mass of that we call a test mass, you can place it here, you can place it here, you can place it here, you can place it pretty close. But the attraction is always going to work for this orientation of drawing towards left. So for this G value to be shown on the positive y-axis, we're assuming this left direction to be positive direction. So the formula for gravitational field strength is given by G equals to Gm by R squared. So you can see that G is a constant, which is a universal gravitational constant. M is the mass of this particle. So ultimately, this equation relates to considering these two variables as constants. They are not actually variable. So ultimately, this should be smaller. Yeah, so we are getting G proportional to 1 upon R squared. So you're basically getting an inverse square relationship, which means if I'm going to try to plot this on a G versus R graph, this graph is going to turn out to be asymptote on both axes. So I'm going to try my best to draw an asymptote graph. And it goes on. So I cannot make it any closer because in that case, I might actually touch it. So the shape of this graph is actually G proportional to 1 upon R squared. So the farther you get away from the planet, the weaker the gravitational field strength is going to be. The closer you get to the planet, the stronger the gravitational potential is going to be. Because in this case, we are considering this to be a particle of zero dimension. So theoretically, you can get literally very close to the point. And the farther close you are going to get, the G value is going to get up, increase exponentially. And this graph is going to be asymptote on both axes for a point mass. As for the potential, before I move on to the potential graph, a graph ta bujha gaya se kina? Regarding this relationship, a graph er drawing ta bujha gaya se kina? Any question about that? Acha, anyone else? Do you have any question?
Sure.
Okay. As for the potential graph, potential is given by phi equals to minus gm by r. Now, what is important? That potential is defined as the amount of work done to bring unit mass from infinite distance to any point of the gravitational field. I'll say it again, try to understand. The amount of work that is done to bring unit mass from infinite distance to any specific point of the gravitational field is defined as the gravitational potential of that point. Because to bring an object from a faraway distance closer to the object, we don't have to do any external work. Rather, the system itself, the gravitational force of the object itself will do the work. So it will always be negative work. So that's the potential is always negative, which means in this case, also, if you consider the GM as to be the G is a constant and M is a constant. So what we're going to get is phi is proportional to minus 1 by R. So we're going to have phi proportional to 1 by R graph, which is going to belong to the negative Y axis. So this is going to be very much basically have a shape like that. Okay. Less steeper closeness to the origin because this is we have a square over here. We don't have a square over here. So this is the graph that is going to represent phi proportional to minus 1 by r. The farther away you are, the less amount of work you have to do. So this is going to be closer to the axis. And the further closer you get, more work and more work will be done by the gravitational field. And theoretically, that work can be infinite if r is 0. So this graph will be asymptotic. Now y-axis as well. So these are the two graphs you're going to get if we have a point object. That's very important. Now what's going to happen if we convert this point object into a sphere, which is the most common case for celestial scenarios. In that case, the mass is going to be distributed over all of the sphere, and we're going to have some amount of variation on these graphs. What are those variations? Which is going to show right over here. For this graph, let's say at the surface, let's say exactly at the surface, here the gravitational field strength is G equals to Gm by R square. Video off. This is the gravitational field strength at the surface. At the surface. For the over huge distance of the infinite hollow space, considering this is an isolated system, this graph is simply going to be continued, just like the way we have seen from the earlier graph, which means this is basically this graph from G equals to R part going down all the way. So that's what's going to happen from the surface outwards, basically considering this as a particle. So this is going to be the graph. So this is basically G proportional to 1 by R square. This is the graph. What's going to happen for the inside? For the inside, it's going to be a bit interesting, more interesting than that. Let me elaborate this. For the inside part, if we drill a hole within the planet and bring up the test mass of 1 kg closer to the planet, the pool of gravitational force is going to become weak on the object. The reason is that, let's say, if we drill a hole from the surface and actually bring the object right over here, the effective gravitational pull that will be experienced by this test 1 kg mass is going to happen from the spherical mass of this much size. Because we now have got closer to the planet, this outer belt of mass will not produce gravitational pull on this thing. Well, you might wonder, why not? They have mass. Well, mathematically, it can be shown, which I'm not showing you right now, is that whenever the object has got inside, you can divide that you have this much mass on the right side of the whole outer belt, and you have this much mass on the left side. So by virtue, this mass is going to pull this mass, this amount of mass is going to pull the 1 kg object to the right, whereas this blue mass is going to pull the object to the left. This blue mass is pretty far away because it is distributed over a longer distance, so on the left side, and this green mass is really close. So theoretically, you might wonder that their attractions are not supposed to be equal. But then again, the distance, the blue mass is far away from this point mass of 1 kg, which is our test mass, using which we are observing the gravitational fields and behavior. The green mass is closer but small in size. It's less mass. Whereas the blue mass is further apart but larger in mass. They are going to compensate for each other's distance and mass effect, and together they're going to produce a perfectly compensating factor, which means the gravitational attraction of this much mass is going to be perfectly counterbalanced by the attraction of this much mass. If you even get slowly closer, then the green mass is going to slowly become bigger and the blue mass is going to slowly become smaller. But then again, the test mass is going to get closer to the blue mass and it's going to get farther from the green mass, and your equilibrium would still maintain. The value of the force might get bigger, will get bigger, but the equilibrium or canceling effect would become same. So bottom line, whenever we are drilling a hole within the planet and bringing in the test object inside the planet, we are going to have the gravitational force of attraction, which is going to be responsible exclusively for the spherical mass that is still underneath the level of the object. So it means that you're now going to experience attraction for a much smaller amount of sphere. Now, the part of this gravitational field strength that goes from the surface to the center of the planet is usually represented like this. The reason why this graph looks like this is not entirely in detail discussed in your syllabus, but I'm going to show you some mathematical derivation for this. It goes on like this. Whenever you are going inside, the effective mass is getting small. Now, the mass of the planet can be given by the density into volume. Consider density as a constant. Volume can be written by 4 by 3 pi r cube. Now, whenever you're considering the formula for g equals to gm by r square, because you are now getting inside this thing, this r is going to become a variable because the radius is actually becoming smaller. So if I replace this expression over here, I might actually get g into density into 4 by 3, this is density into 4 by 3, pi r cube multiplied by r squared. So g constant, density constant, 4 by 3 constant, pi constant, r cube, r squared cross out of here, so you get r. So ultimately you are going to get g equals to some huge constant with all of these numbers. Let me use blue maybe, with all of these things. I mean, all of these things are within this box, I'm not writing them, multiplied by r. So for this inside part, we have the gravitational field strength getting directly proportional to r. So we basically y equals to mx, a straight line that passes through the origin. That's why for the inside part of the gravitational field strength, we get a straight line that passes through the origin. This is supposed to be a straight line, although it doesn't look much of a straight line, but this is the gravitational field strength you're gonna get. This is why the gravitational graph looks like this, because you're gonna start experiencing a much weaker force if you start drilling within the planet, and exactly at the center of the planet, you're gonna have zero gravitational force, not infinite gravitational force. You have to understand that although this formula says gm by r squared, you might feel like that, well, r becoming zero, g should become infinite. Yes, obviously it should become infinite, provided it used to be a point mass, which I showed you right over on this graph right over here. So if it was a point mass like this, then it should become infinite. But for a celestial planet, it's not a point mass, it's actually a spherical mass, which means the more you get into the from the surface inside, you are going to start having a reduction, significant reduction of the m value as well. So you are losing r, you're also losing m. So eventually you're going to have almost no physical attraction of the gravitational pull, or practically speaking, the gravitational attraction will be perfectly balanced in all directions. So you're going to have zero force, and zero force by virtue is going to give you zero gravitational attraction. So that's what happens for the inside part. A derivation ta bujha geche kina, logical explanation ta bujha geche kina?
Yes, sir.
Kar kono confusion?
No, sir.
Acha. এরপর যে পাঁচটা পার্ট আমরা দেখো, সেটা হচ্ছে ফাইয়ের জন্য আমাদের জিনিসটা দরকার, সেটা হচ্ছে what happens for phi. Now here is the thing that you need to understand, this requires a bit of a visualization. Phi এর চাচা আমি গ্রাফটা আগে আঁকি, তারপর আমি গ্রাফের এক্সপ্লেনেশনটা বলবো। সেই গ্রাফের এক্সপ্লেনেশন জন্য আমি খুব একটা ফর্মুলা দেখাবো না, আমি জাস্ট গোনা ইউজ ওয়ার্ডস টু এক্সপ্লেইন দিস থিং। The phi part from the surface all the way to the infinite distance is gonna be just like the way I showed you earlier. This curve is given by phi proportional to minus 1 by r, which is coming from the expression phi equals to minus gm by r. So what happens for the inside? Now here's the thing that I need you to understand. Try to visualize this thing. I'm gonna draw over here to help you visualize. Let's say you have a planet right over here which has a mass of m. Let's assume that here we have infinite distance, figure not drawn to scale. At this point, you're gonna start to move 1 kg object, which is your test mass, to measure the exit potential over here. So if you bring an if you allow an object to fall from infinite distance into the planet, and by virtue of the gravitational pull or gravitational force, let's say the object travels from this location to this location, so it comes right over here, and to move this much distance is gonna experience some amount of work done, because this is force into distance covered. And you have to understand this force is actually variable, because we're talking about significantly large amount of distance change. So the force is going to be variable. The distance is also is not actually a distance, a linear distance. So if you undergo some sort of integration, then you can calculate how much work is done. But you have to understand, let's say the amount of work that is done over here is, let's say, 10 joule. And we moved an object of 1 kg. So we're going to say that the potential of this location would be minus 10 joule per kg. Why? Because we had to, the field did 10 joule of work to move 1 kg object from infinite distance to this distance. If we want to bring this object even further, then we would have to, this phi would become even more negative. So let's say somewhere over here, this might as well be 15 joule per kg. I'm just assuming these numbers. The closer you're gonna get to the planet, the bigger negative number this is gonna become, which is obvious. Now, up to the planet's surface, this is going to keep on working just like that. And once you reach the planet's surface, you're going to get a pretty high or large negative number. Let's say at the planet's surface, this gravitational potential is minus 1000. I'm just assuming these numbers without any possibility of repercussion. So just assuming this number. So let's say at the surface, the gravitational potential is minus 1000 joules per kg. Now, what's going to happen if you start to move the object inside this planet? The idea is that if you start to move this planet inside, if you start to move this 1 kg object inside the planet, then you are not going to consider the entire part of the graph, entire right part of the graph, working under the same amount of gravitational force. Try to understand this thing. Remember this thing. For this entire movement, the entire mass M was responsible, which means for any part of this equation, if you are trying to calculate the gravitational force, you could use gm into 1 divided by r square. G is the gravitational field strength, m is the mass of the planet, 1 is the mass of this test object. So these are the two masses divided by r square. You could use this mass. The moment you start to get inside the planet, your mass is not going to be capital M anymore. It's going to become somewhat smaller, which means for all the graph that you have drawn or for all the values that you have now calculated, this entire value is going to become somewhat changed. That's why to represent the gravitational potential graph, what we do is that we always prefer to draw the potential curve all the way up to the surface by a solid line. And then we simply complete the graph with a dotted line over here. This part of the graph is, even if you don't show it, it might not be wrong, but the reason we prefer to show it is because it's just to signify, is the reason we show it is just to signify that even whenever we're gonna bring the object close to the planet, if we don't bring it any further closer, this amount of work was done by the planet, which is, let's say, 1000 joule for a 1 kg mass brought from the infinite distance. And if we keep the object at the surface, this amount of work is done and it is done. You cannot revoke this. This amount of work that is done by the planet or the planet's gravitational field is already have been completed. By moving the object inside, it's simply not going to become less. It's going to have a different type of values, which is not shown over here, because in that case, the mass is going to become smaller. Your gravitational equation is not going to be hold true anymore. So that's why we prefer not to draw this, at least not for your level. You can look up for the significant further discussion for this thing. But what we prefer, why this is different compared to the, why is this different from the gravitational field strength graph? What do you need to understand? Whenever we are moving inside the planet, the actual attraction of the planet onto the 1 kg mass test object, that is actually getting smaller. We could actually measure this. And because G is defined directly by definition, G is what? Gravitational force divided by the test mass. In this case, that test mass is considered to be 1 kg for the sake of easier calculation and easier representation. So force could be very easily shown over here. This is basically force per mass. So this could be well drawn on this graph. But this one over here is actually work done per kg. And because we have already made this work, whenever you're going to move inside this thing, inside the planet, this work is not going to become zero. I mean, the planet is still going to keep on attracting the mass, and the mass is still going to get work done by the virtue of the gravitational field of the big mass capital M. That's why it's still going to experience a much more reduction of the gravitational potential. But because this part of the graph is not going to hold true anymore, that's why we prefer not to draw this graph like this. We simply complete the graph, or let's say we do not complete the graph, we just show that this potential is just represented by this much. If you wonder what are the possible other versions of this graph might be, here are multiple other versions. First of all, if this planet was squashed, if this planet was squashed to a smaller radius, but having the same mass, let's say in that case, this graph could simply be brought even further closer like that. Let's say this same M mass was squashed to a radius of this much size. Let's say the planet was actually this much size. So you're moving the test mass from infinite distance 1 kg here, and you're getting closer. But if the same mass is constituted within a smaller volume, you're simply going to have this curve continued further till the surface. If the mass is considered to be squashed with a zero volume, or for example, the case of a particle, then you're going to have an asymptote graph. So the smaller the size of the planet is going to become, the more your graph can approach towards the y-axis. If the planet actually becomes perfectly zero volume, then you're going to have the graph become asymptote, and vice versa like that. Tell me what didn't make sense. I'm going to zoom out these two graphs so that you can have a bit of a comparison between what happens for a circular or spherical object and what happens for a point object. So these are the two different variations. Any question?
No, sir.
Potentially a graph to be the extent column.
Kothay?
Potentially a graph to be the extent column R.
So you're saying that whether the graph is going to get inside or not?
Yes, sir. Sorry.
If you asked a question for which you thought the answer and you think the answer is okay, so that's why you're retracting your question, or do you need me to answer the question yet?
To answer, Gordon.
Okay, yes. You got the answer. So that's the basic part of the graph, and that's how the difference of the graphs are done. And this is actually shown in the class notes within this part. Where is that? Ekhane. So you just have to remember these graphs for your gravitational field chapter. However, whenever we're going to see the Coulomb's law in the chapter of static electricity, actually electrostatic forces, then we're going to have much more variation of this similar type of graphs. This is a much more simpler version. For those of you who are not feeling this is simpler, I'm telling you there'll be composite complicated graphs showing up pretty soon. So it's important that you understand the underlying logic behind it. So that's why I went through the process to show you that practically this graph that you're showing, G versus R, or field strength versus distance, is actually an inverse square graph. And potential versus distance is basically a negative inverse graph. The square is missing here. That's the key part, considering their particles. But whenever you have spherical objects where the mass is distributed over a volume, then you have a bit of a change of this main graph, so which can look like this. Moving on to some other discussion that we actually didn't do from this note that we that I just remembered, that these things, that what happens for a horizontal circle, what happens for a vertical circle. So vertical circle, I get horizontal circle for it. Horizontal circle, example, I should zoom out. And zoom in 100%, good. Horizontal circle er onek dhoroner example hoite pare to je example typically ami most commonly porai seta hocche, consider this scenario. Let's say here is a roof and we are hanging an object with some mass using a string from the roof. Let's say the length of the effective length from the center of from the roof all the way to the center of the bob, let's call it bob, or maybe a pendulum for example. Let's the total length over here is L. So all the way up to this much. Once again, we are considering this whole mass to be a particle having mass but zero volume. So that's that. Now we can set these objects motion in a horizontal circle. So horizontal circle means, let's say we're gonna pull this object to one side, and then we're gonna give it a bit of a push parallel to the horizontal. That can set up a horizontal motion of this bob, can somewhat look like this. The mass is going to move around in a circular movement. So disregard this drawing. This is a bit of a convoluted drawing of two-dimensional and three-dimensional mixed up. But what I'm trying to show you is that consider this thing as a flat circle. Do not consider that the object is actually moving vertically. So this is representing a horizontal circle. Let's say this object is going around within the circular path where the object has some velocity. Let's say the linear velocity of this circular motion, this is considered to be a full circle. So this is the view of this moving object from an angle. If you look at this thing from the very top, this is from an angle, so I shouldn't write this. If you look at it from the very top, you might actually see a perfectly circle. Microsoft Word board, make it a circle. Yeah, beautiful. So let's say it's going to be a circle, which is going to have so this is the object. It is going around in circular motion with a linear velocity, let's say like this, which is V. I'm going to label this as V as well. And the radius over here, this radius of circular motion is actually this much part, or maybe this much part. So we're going to talk about the variables that is relevant here. This length of the string is still going to be available over here. So the length of this right angle triangle, the hypotenuse is going to be L. Let's say this angle is theta of the conic of the, this is a, what you call the vertex angle for the conical shape that this string is going to keep on making. In that case, this side is going to be L cos theta, and this side is going to be L sine theta. So in this case, the radius of the circular motion is L sine theta, and the speed is V. So we can try to get some mathematics out of this particle. What you need to see, let me zoom in and try to draw individual forces on this object, maybe use a different color. In this direction, we're gonna have the tension of the string. In this direction, we're gonna have weight of the particle working vertically downwards, irrespective of the particle's position, velocity, orientation, whatever. Weight always works vertically downwards. Towards the center, for this position of the bob, towards the center, we're gonna have the centripetal force working. The object is gonna keep on moving like this. What you have to understand that this object, although it's moving around in a circle and it's actually not going anywhere, it is not at equilibrium. Mark my words, the object that we are having moving in a horizontal circle is not in equilibrium because it is continuously undergoing circular motion, which means it is in a continuous state of having acceleration. It is always having delta V because its direction is always changing, which means because it's continuous accelerating, there is a resultant force working on the object. What do we call that resulting force for circular motion? We call that resulting force the centripetal force. The centripetal force is responsible to cause the circular motion of this object around this horizontal circle. Now, because we have three forces available over here, I have labeled three forces over here. What I want to write and appreciate this equation, the resultant force in this case is Fc, writing a vector, which should be the outcome of the vector sum of T and W. Fc should be the total outcome coming up from T and W. Now you might wonder how does that even happen. Well, I can try to draw the triangle figure. So I can draw the triangle figure over here. So T and W should give you Fc. How? For this position, this is the direction of the T. Let's say this is the value of T, and then W is working downwards. So I can try to draw the W from this one using a different color. So W is going to be only this much, such that this is your vector force T, this is your vector force W, tension and weight. And the resultant force, which I might show my blue, is gonna be working in this way. So this is your Fc. So T plus W gives you Fc, where this much is the angle. And you can essentially work out all the values over here. So that's one way to show it within the expression for the expression of triangle rule. But if I still want to go over here, I can actually derive the T values to give you a bit more understanding for how the whole thing works. I'm using green just to have a different value. Let's say theta is over here. So I can draw an assumed vertical line and draw the theta over here as well. These triangles are equal because they are rectangle, alternate angle or corresponding angle. No. What do you call these angles? Corresponding angles? What do you call these two angles?
Alternate
angles. Parallel lines er jonno the transversal angle ta hoy angle er ki bole eta alternate na eta alternate angles. So because they are alternate angles, so these two angles are exactly equal. So if I use this angle for this t value, I can draw over here, this is going to be my t cos theta component, and towards this direction I'm going to have my t sin theta component. The way this whole circular motion is going to be balanced is that for every single part of the motion, no matter how much you set your theta or whatever, your t cos theta will be always, your t cos theta will be always be equal to W, whereas your t sin theta will be the resultant force, which is your centripetal force, which is also your resultant force, and which can be written as m v square by r, or you can also write it as m omega square r. So that's how the whole circular motion is going to work out. Now, yeah, IPS er jamono bokmono ei part tuk bujhe geche kina je ei circular motion er force distribution ta kibhabe hocche. Is it making sense?
Yes sir.
What happens for a vertical circle? Now, vertical circles can prove to be before you get into vertical circle, this set of equation is actually applicable for any position of the mass that is going around in horizontal cycle. For the sake of easier understanding, I showed it onto this position. I could have also shown it over here, but drawing it in any of this position would require a bit more difficulty in drawing because this is gonna be isometric. But no matter where you consider this particle, this set of equation is always gonna be hold true. But that's not the case for a vertical circle of circular motion. What do we mean by vertical circle? Have a look. Let's say you have a mass attached with a spring in your hand, and you start to make a circular motion that is vertical with the horizontal with the ground. Which means if this is the surface of the earth, you're gonna make the object go around like this. The earlier example was we are moving this object like that, but currently we are moving the object in a perfectly vertical circle. So the motion of the whole thing is vertical, it's a vertical circle, whatever. So how can we consider the four situations for a vertical circle? Here are a couple of examples. Vertical circle can prove to be a bit more difficult compared to horizontal circle because there is variation of forces and direction is somewhat different. So let's say this is a vertical circle. Beautiful. I'm gonna make it large, a bit more large. Nice. Okay. This is not a perfect circle, but bear with me. This is a circular motion. This is the track of the vertical circle. Let's say this is the center of the vertical motion. We're now moving, let's say, a mass of M. Let's say I'm showing this mass in a random position over here. This is going to keep on going around in an uniform speed, uniform beat. So we are assuming the motion to be of uniform speed of, let's say, V. So to maintain this speed, that resultant force that you're going to require in any case is going to be mv squared by r, where r is the radius of this vertical circle, measured in any direction, doesn't matter, or it can be m omega squared r. And that is your resultant force. Important. This is your resultant force. You have to obtain this force from all the available forces in this case. For the sake of easier explanation, what we do is we only discuss at your level exclusively two positions of the vertical circle movement, exclusively two positions and not anymore. We do not consider any other points, but I'm going to shed some light for what happens on the other points just because I want to. So let's say the two positions that we consider in our syllabus, one is on exit on the top of the center. The other position is exit at the bottom of the center. So what happens at the top of the center? Here's the deal. You are going making the object go around in circular motion with holding a string in your hand. So this was the situation. Let's say this is the same thing. You took it off from the ceiling and now you are making it go around in a horizontal circle, sorry, vertical circle, by pulling the string towards your hand. Your pull is always going to work towards the hand, and centripetal force will always going to work towards the hand. However, the weight will always work vertically downwards. Important bit. Your tension of the string is going to work towards center. Your FC, which is the resultant force, is also going to work towards the center. However, weight is going to work vertically down. Arrow works better. So if we consider the top position here, let me write different color. What should I use for different color? Let's say I'm going to use black for FC. Let's say in this case, the FC is going to be in this way. This much should be your FC, resultant force. The weight should work vertically down. Let's say this is the weight. And your tension should also work vertically down. So I'm showing tension by T. So let's say T is also working vertically down. And this equation will also hold true. Fc will be made available by the vector sum of tension and weight. In this case, tension, when the object is exactly on the top position of the vertical circle, tension and weight both are working in the same direction, which means here Fc can be obtained by the actual sum of T plus W, because they are working in the same direction. What happens to tension and what happens to W? I'm going to talk about these parts just a bit later, but bear with me. What happens over here? Even for this position, for a uniform circular motion, the Fc should still work towards the center, which means in this case, vertically upward. So I'm giving double arrow. Fc is going to work in the upward direction. Weight is going to work vertically downwards. So weight in this case is going to work by the same magnitude downwards. Tension has to be such big, because you have to understand that tension plus weight should work, give you the Fc. Tension in this case has to be such big so that it can compensate for the reverse direction of the weight and give rise or add value to the centripetal force. So for this case, red, tension is going to work towards the center with a significantly large value. I'm still going to write the same equation because I'm writing a vector equation. So Fc is going to be the vector sum of T plus W. Now, in this case, T is much more bigger because W is now working in the opposite direction. But because this is a vector sum, I'm not writing this much. I'm not writing a minus because that would be, I could write this in minus, but if I want to write this as in minus, I should name them differently. Let's say I'm going to write this equation in a different expression. So I'm going to write, let's say, T at the top plus W. This is the actual sum. Whereas if I write T at the bottom, this is bottom, and this is what? This is the top tension at the top position. That doesn't work. Okay. Tension at the top, tension at the bottom. In this case, I can actually write minus. So, and I should actually get rid of the vector signs over here because I just signified their values. Messing up the equations because I am not a very good teacher. Okay, so for this case, the sum of these two forces is going to give rise to the centripetal force. And for this case, the difference of these two forces, where tension has to be bigger because weight is working in the opposite direction of the centripetal force, tension has to be bigger. And the subtraction of these two forces gives rise to the centripetal force. These are the two exclusive cases that we have for you have for your syllabus. Now, important bit. Let's say you have the object going around in circles. I'm going to take questions from you. Just if you have questions, just hold your horses for a couple of more minutes. If we keep on increasing the orbital circular speed or the angular speed of this object going around in circles, so, or if we say, if we start to increase this V value, try to understand what's going to happen. If we start to increase this V value, Fc is going to start going higher. So for this case, if Fc goes higher, W is a constant, so your TT is going to become higher, your TB is also going to become higher. But you have to always understand that the tension at the top will always be the smallest, whereas the tension at the bottom is always going to be the largest, because here this two for weight is working towards additively towards the Fc, whereas weight is working subtractively towards Fc. So tension at the lowest position will always be highest. If we keep on increasing the angular velocity of this whole rotation, there would come a point where the tension of the string is gonna become more than the force that the string is capable to sustain. And if that force goes over the breaking value of the whole string, you might have this vertical circle motion. The string might actually get torn up. And the most likely position, the obvious position where the string might break, if we keep on increasing the circular speed further, if we keep on increasing the angular speed of the whole thing, the position of the object where that string might break is exactly at the bottom position. So let's say you're increasing this thing and you're having tension increasing, tension decreasing. So as the object slowly falls from here to here, tension keeps on increasing, maximum tension. And then tension decreases, minimum tension. And that's how the whole tension varies over the whole cycle. if the tension ever breaks at this point, if the tension is such high that the string actually breaks at the while the when the stone is at the lowest position, in that case you're gonna have a sudden break of the string. So let me use maybe another color. You're gonna have a sudden break of the string. The TB is gonna be vanished, FC is gonna be vanished, but the object would have some momentary velocity horizontal to the ground in this direction, and it will be subjected to the weight. So which means now it's gonna start to go in a projectile motion. So this can be a subsequent scenario of the whole math where you might have to consider. I'm not saying this will show up, but this might show up. If I was a physics teacher, I would try to set up questions like that, that a vertical circle is going this way, and I give you the properties, tensile stress or the breaking stress of the string material, and I ask you to find out that what is the angular velocity at which the string breaks up, by which you can calculate the linear velocity of this point at the point of the string breaking up. The moment the string breaking up, you have a projectile motion of horizontal projectile, and you know the velocity. I can then ask you that how far this stone is going to travel before it hits the ground, provided this object was, or provided some height information was provided. So you can have a composition of multiple different ideas of physics so far you have learned about. In my example over here, I have included the idea of force equation for a vertical circle, then a little bit about the elasticity chapter, then a subsequent motion of the projectile motion might be also a part of the whole equation. I don't assume that CIA would actually go for this kind of complicated questions, but this type of questions are very common in the IB syllabus, International Baccalaureate, and they make questions which actually makes a holistic approach towards a practical application of a real life scenario where you have to apply multiple different concepts that you have come across logically so that you can solve problems and come up with values. And in the IB syllabus, what is interesting for the IB syllabus, I know about IB syllabus, I never taught IB syllabus, but I actually went through the syllabus content to find out difficult questions for your mock questions, mock papers, and final exam preparation. So that's why I know this stuff, that you don't only get marks for correct answers. There are a lot of marks provided, by far more than 50% marks are provided for the appropriate approach towards solving the problem. If the examiners find out that you knew what to do for the problem, but you somehow messed up the calculation, or you couldn't make enough time, you couldn't finish your calculation, you're still going to be awarded a whole lot of marks, because it shows that you know how to work your way through the problem. Maybe you are not as good as other people, or maybe you are not as good as average, but as long as you know how to solve the problem, you deserve marks. Questions. I'll take questions from here. I'm zooming out so that you can have a look at the total thing. Anyone? Question?
String to extend for the tension value change of it.
Tensioner value change hobe, acha ha bolte chhi seta hocche, let's say for a constant v, consider that the object is going around in a constant v. I'm saying constant v, but later I'm going to start increasing the value of v, because for the timing just consider that we have a constant v for the sake of easy understanding. If you have a constant v, then your fc is going to be also be constant, because it is mv square by r. M is a constant, R is a constant, if V is a constant, the centripetal force is also constant, which means for each and every position of the mass over this entire circle, you're going to have the same FC value working towards the center. I'm actually not being able to draw towards the center, but consider all of these forces towards the center. So that FC is going to be same. I'm drawing black arrows to be FCs.
Constant velocity, how we can have vertical circle?
Sorry?
Vertical circle, like constant velocity, how we can.
বুঝিনি আর বলো
ভার্টিক্যাল সার্কেল না
আচ্ছা
আই ভেলোসিটি কনস্ট্যান্ট হবে
আই এম
পটেনশিয়াল এনার্জি তারপরে কাইনেটিক এনার্জি কনভার্সন জন্য
আচ্ছা হ্যাঁ ওটা তো আবার ফল ডাউন করবে আর রাইজ আপ করবে সো কিভিং দা ভেলোসিটি কনস্ট্যান্ট মাইট বি ভেরি ডিফিকাল্ট আইডিয়া রাইট আচ্ছা ইন্টারেস্টিং বিট দাঁড়াও আমি একটা জিনিস বাই করে তোমাদেরকে দেখাই
I guess like in proshoma energy dite thako tension diye like
exactly we got it yeah এটাই আমি পাঠাইছি এটা তোমাদেরকে আমি পাঠাই দেই তোমরা চাইলে এখান থেকে দেখে নিতে পারো আমি বলতেছি এটা কি জিনিস just let me just show you what they are showing up over here is that if we have an object going around in vertical circle here they have actually considered the object in a random position and trying to derive the equations for different parts this is the lowest position currently the object is at a vertical height h above from the lowest position and this 2r is the maximum height the object might get this is the highest position capital h and this is the median position here shown as capital M they have shown over here two tensions T1 for the highest position T2 for the lowest position and T3 for the considered direction over here and the idea is that vector sum of T3 plus MG should give you FC this is a given fact I mean that equation is always held true however because the object is actually moving in vertical circles you have to consider the energy consideration as well So what they are saying, let V be the velocity of the velocity at any point on P on the vertical circle. Let L be the lowest point on the vertical circle. Let H be the height of the point P above point L. Let U be the velocity of the body at L. So they have defined that here you have a speed of U, and at any point other than this initial point, the variable velocity is V. And considering that the energy should be same everywhere, we are considering that a scenario of without zero energy loss. So energy at point P should be equal to energy at point L. So that way we can add up the half mv square plus mgh equals to half mu square, and from there we can get v equals to root over of u square minus 2gh. So it means the v cannot be made into a constant. If you have equal amount of energy for the whole circular motion, your v is actually going to be variable. My bad, I said it wrong. When I was discussing it, I messed up this part. V is not supposed to be a constant. If v is made into a constant, then fc can be a constant. That part is correct, but for non-energy fed scenario, I mean, let's say you have the object moving around in vertical circle, you're gonna have this equation leading to the instantaneous velocity of the particle u square minus 2gh. So if it's at the lowest position, you're gonna have the highest velocity. The farther it goes up, you're gonna have less velocity. So it's gonna have different values of linear velocity at individual different points. The lowest velocity is gonna be on the top, and highest velocity is gonna be at the bottom. So that's the expression for the linear velocity, and then they have calculated the total thing. Consider the centripetal forces to point P. So centripetal force mv squared by r, v is also the variable, and t minus mg cos theta. Where does that come from? This is the tension of the t, and mg cos theta is working that way, which is a component of mg. So if we do separate these two parts, we get the instantaneous centripetal force for this exclusive position. So they didn't write t3. They could, but they didn't bother to, because they are showing this t over here as a variable that is related to the angle theta. So t minus mg cos theta equals to mv squared by r. So t equals to mv cos theta plus mv squared by r. And from the figure, this is the equation. So they replace this thing. Ultimately, we are getting this expression. The variable t is going to be m by r u squared minus 3gh plus gr. This is the expression for the tension in the string. That's how the tension is going to be varied for a vertical circle. You don't have this all of this calculation for your syllabus, because it's somewhat considered to be too much difficult for you. But we have these three special cases. One is for the top position, one is for the halfway position, one is for the lowest position. So they can have this kind of these three individual expressions. And from here, you should be able to see that you have the biggest amount of tension when the particle is actually at the lowest position. Zarif, does that answer your question somewhat? Zarif left the chat. Okay, he might be back. Someone left, whoever, whatever. We are now at 6. Bujhe geche ki bolchi?
Ji sir.
It's actually not that difficult. You don't have to bother to learn all of these equations. You don't have to, but if you're interested to look into the equation and build up of the equation, I mean, you don't have to essentially learn anything by heart or memorize anything. You shouldn't have to memorize much stuff for physics. What really requires is that you understand how the whole thing works in a logical construct way, that you do not mess up the ideas of physics in cases. For example, if you know that the vector sum of the weight and the tension gives rise to the centripetal force, that is a concept that is held true for all of the positions. So no matter how you build up your equation, that concept shouldn't be waste. For example, here they have used this concept to give rise to that equation. So just have a understanding how the equation actually is coming into formation. You don't have to remember the derivation, but it can be a good resource for you in case you find it confusing. And if you are trying to figure out the motion for other points as well. Yeah, that's all I wanted to say. So V is not supposed to be constant for a vertical circle at any point, because we have a continuous change of GP to K and K to GP. So V is supposed to be a variable for the whole motion. And V would be a variable regarding on the tension of the object. So centripetal force is gonna be variable as well, because mv squared by r. Yeah, centripetal force will also be variable. Yep. Because you're gonna have high speed over here, so you're gonna require less centripetal force. You're gonna have you're gonna have low speeds on the for the upper half of the vertical circle, so you're gonna require less centripetal force, and you're gonna have increased speed for the lower part of the motion, so you're gonna have higher centripetal force requirement. So depending upon the value of the v, your requirement for centripetal force will also be different. So that's that from there. I'd like all of you to read through this paragraph a little bit. For those who have actually obtained the notes, you might actually have this thing. For those who haven't, I'm going to try to zoom in it as much as I can so that you can actually read Adnan Sami's handwriting, which is very good. So, yeah. So have a read at this paragraph, try to make sense with it. I'll be right back. 2 minutes. All right, I'm back. So now we can try to solve some problems from the worksheet, if that's okay with all of us. We have time.
Sir, I'm not string and length a constant for both.
For the timing, yes. If we can consider the string length to be constant, or if you want to consider this to be an elastic string, then it would have a shape like an egg, more length on the lower side, smaller length on the top side. Something like that. Okay. এখানে একটা কোশ্চেন আছে যেখানে হচ্ছে স্ট্রিং এর লেন্থটা কনস্ট্যান্ট না, এই যে এখানে একটা ইলাস্টিক স্ট্রিং নিয়ে ম্যাথস ম্যাথস করা আছে, সো উই ক্যান ট্রাই টু সলভ দিস থিংস অ্যাজ ওয়েল, মাইট অ্যাজ ওয়েল. আচ্ছা আমি শুরু থেকে স্টার্ট করি. ইফ ইউ হ্যাভ এ গো ফর কোশ্চেন নাম্বার ওয়ান, আচ্ছা অ্যাকচুয়ালি ইট উড বি হেল্পফুল ইফ আই input the PDF maybe. Insert all pages. Bam. Koi yellow. Okay. So yep. তোমার কি ওয়ার্কশিট উঠেছে সবাই? Maybe. Let's try to solve this problem. The Earth may be considered to be an uniform sphere of radius 6.3 × 10⁶ meter. Its mass is assumed to be concentrated at its center, which means we can assume it to be a particle. Given that the gravitational field strength at the Earth's surface is 9.81 Newton per kg, show that the mass of the Earth is 5.99 × 10⁴ kg. This is pretty simple. You just write G equals to Gm by R square. You are subject to, and then subject M from here. So M is equals to GR square. You can write capital R, or you can write smaller. The variables doesn't matter, but actually maintain the same variable everywhere, divided by G. The value of G would be available to you in the formula sheet, so you don't have to memorize that. But since I do remember this thing, so I'm gonna write this 9.1 into 6.38 × 10⁶ whole squared divided by 6.67 × 10⁻³. So you calculate this up, you're gonna get 5.99 × 10⁴ kg. So that's the first thing. Number B says a satellite is placed in geostationary orbit around the Earth. Calculate the angular speed of the satellite in its orbit. Okay, I forgot to talk to you about geostationary orbit. Now might be a good time. Geostationary orbits are those geostationary satellites. This is actually a word, geostationary. Geostationary satellites are those satellites which have a fixed position in the sky with respect to any position of the Earth on the Earth surface. What they mean is that they are gonna orbit the Earth as if they are not moving with respect to Earth. Try to understand this thing. They are gonna orbit the Earth as if they are not moving at all with respect to Earth, which means Earth has a orbital, the time period for Earth's one full rotation on its own axis is one day, 24 hours. So geostationary satellites should also have an orbital period of 24 hours, and they must be on an equatorial plane. This is a word, equatorial. They must be on an equatorial plane. So what it means is that, let's say if this is the Earth, and let's say this is the equator, and if I extend this thing, this is an equatorial plane. This is a view seen from the side. So the plane is seen as a straight line. Geostationary satellite should be somewhere over here in such a way that they are gonna complete their one full orbit around the Earth in 24 hours. Now, why should they be in the equatorial orbit? Because the whole idea of geostationary is that they should be at a fixed position in the sky with respect to the Earth. So if the Earth rotates by, let's say, 20 degree angle on its axis, that satellite should also move by 20 degree angle in its circular orbit. And if it is not on geostationary satellite, if the satellite is let's say on a 24 hour orbit but not on the equatorial plane, let's say the plane is like this, in that case what's going to happen for a person on the planet, on the Earth, looking at this planet, looking at this thing, this person is going to see that this thing is going down and up. So when the satellite is going to travel from here to here, any person on the Earth surface is going to observe that this thing is actually going down with respect to their position. They are moving in the same circular motion, so it would be seen pretty much on the same vertical element in the sky, but it would be seen to move down. And then when it will be and all the way up to here, it will be seen to move down, and then all the way up in this part, it will be seen to move up. So that's not going to be geostationary, because the whole point of geostationary is that it's going to be located in a fixed position in the sky. So that's the idea of geostationary orbit. Geostationary satellites are really far away from the Earth because their time period is pretty large, because we have seen this thing, T is proportional to R cube, remember, Kepler's law. So this T is for geostationary satellites is about 24 hours. So their orbital radius is actually pretty high. They are pretty far away from the Earth, but they serve a very critical role in telecommunication purposes, because they are fixed in a single position on the sky. We don't have to track them. Tracking essentially means, in satellite communication, tracking means that you have to know, either manually or within your computer setup, where a certain satellite is in the sky, and you have to aim your sent data signal towards that satellite position so that you can have effective communication. For geostationary satellites, they're always in the same position in the sky, so you don't have to change the angle of the ground antenna, which is used to communicate with that satellite. You can have a fixed antenna, so you can build it to be large. Well, it needs to be large because the distance is actually quite big. So from the Earth to the orbit, back to the Earth, the distance is actually quite large. So you need a pretty large antenna to have good communication quality. And you can also develop some lag in communication. Lag means there will be a significant time delay for the communication to be accomplished, because even though the electromagnetic waves travel at 320 meters per second, for this much of an R cube amount of radius, orbital radius for geostationary satellites, that signal, I mean, sending a signal from a ground station, which should reach to the geostationary satellite and eventually come back to the station, this actually takes a measurable amount of time, maybe in terms of millisecond, but there is a bit of a gap or a bit of a lag that can happen. So it has some benefit, it has some drawbacks, but we have this system developed. Geostationary satellites have another disadvantage, is that they cannot provide satellite coverage for the whole planet, because let's say you have a geostationary satellite right over here. If you draw a tangent from this position to the Earth's surface, let's say this is the tangent, not a very good tangent. So let's say this is the tangent right over here. So it can provide communication up to a certain latitude. So let's say this much part of the Earth can be covered by geostationary satellites coverage. So this part close to the pole, this much part cannot have geostationary satellite, because for these locations on the Earth close to the pole, beyond a certain latitude, the geostationary satellites would be beyond the horizon. So to have effective communication, we have to have some additional satellites, which are called polar satellites, which can rotate above the pole. So they will, every once in a while, they'll be rotating above the pole, but they will never be geostationary, because they have to have an orbit which is not equatorial, because that's the whole point of polar satellites, so that they can provide coverage. And we need to have a network of them. Only one of them would not be a good idea. If we have only one polar satellite in the Earth, which we don't, but if we did have only one, the polar people are going to have the communication opportunity for a limited duration of the time, every time at every every multiple times within a day, but the communication window would be small, maybe 5 minutes, till the satellite is going above them. And then as long as the satellite is moving through the other part of the Earth, they don't have any communication opportunity. But if we have a network or multiple satellites set up in a certain way that any of the satellites of all of those constellations, they actually have some sort of, they are, at least one of them is always above the polar region, you can have a way to continuous communication. But to have UTC communication from the polar regions using the polar satellites, you need to have the tracking ability in your devices. Tracking means your setup of the ground station antennas should know where in the sky that satellite is, and it should continuously change its aim as the satellite moves away. So that's important. For those of you who keep up with SpaceX and its business ventures, SpaceX is the space company set up by Elon Musk. They are one of their commercial products that they are trying to get hugely rely upon is the Starlink internet services. They are using very small, a huge number of satellites to go around the Earth. And their ground antenna actually has the capability of tracking. It actually automatically moves and aims at certain satellites in the sky and can provide some pretty good bandwidth in places where local network is not very much available. For those of you who know who you know, for those who don't know, don't bother. You might get interested into these stuff because that's pretty much the technological movement that is going around. Do you understand the concept of geostationary satellite and the equatorial orbit? Is it clear? Sir, I'm just going to act
the
geostationary
opposite side of the coverage
problem. Zarif, you have a background noise. You have a question. Chat room, you have a I really appreciate that. I have the chat window over here, so if you're right, I'll see it. Well, if you only use one geostationary satellite, no. If you only use one geostationary satellite, we wouldn't be able to cover this thing. As far as I know, that minimum number of satellites that are required to provide coverage for the entire Earth effectively is 7. If you have 7 geostationary satellites around the whole equatorial orbit, you can have good communication quality and capability for the entire Earth. But theoretically, it can be less. Theoretically, it can be less because theoretically, it would be only the minimum number. So you might only consider tangent to tangent, but that would provide good communication capability for some people, poor communication capability for some other people. So might not be a good idea. Typically we have 7, but if you need, you can essentially install more, but one doesn't essentially give you. One will not give you, one will only give you communication capability for only the people above which the geostationary satellite is located. I think that makes sense. Right, butcho. Okay, good. Achha, I was solving the paper using data in air determine the radius of the orbit. So ekhan radius of the orbit bear korar jonno amader lagbe hocche r. So we know that t square proportional to r cube, but that equation itself is not going to help us. If you remember the orbital radius equation, well and good. If you don't remember the orbital radius equation, then you might actually start by writing this way. This is how you might start. So you might actually write that Fg equals to Fc. So Gmm by R square equals to M omega square R. Mm cross us out, so which means R cube, so Gm divided by omega square equals to R cube. I'm not breaking that omega square over here because we just calculated omega over here, so I want to place that number over here for dir calculation. So r is going to be root over cube root, actually cube root of gm by omega square. So g is a constant that is available from the formula sheet. M you just calculate over here, omega you calculate over here, place all these numbers, you should be get this number within a acceptable correct value. So that's question number one. Question number two says Debye gravitational potential, that's the definition. You should look out in the Mars schemes to get a proper definition of the definitions. One of the things that you actually would come across, I'm not saying this is going to happen most of the time, but this can happen some of the times, is that for the same quantity, you might come across multiple different type of definitions in different questions. The reason you might have these variations is that there might not be, in many cases, the same amount of number for the same question. I mean, in this question, they are asking that Debye gravitational potential, and they have two marks in it. In some questions, it might be one. In some questions, it might be three. So depending on how many marks is allocated for that specific question, although the question sounds exactly the same, it's identical question, but if there are different amount of marks, you might have different, the answer might have different level of depth within itself. So I would always recommend that you try to look out for these references on your own. I'm not gonna make you aware for every individual examples, but generally speaking, try to look out for these differences and try to have your own set of data so that you do know that if a certain question have more marks in it, how this question should be answered. However, the basic definition of gravitational potential is very simple. Amount of work done slash energy required to move unit mass from infinite distance to any point of a gravitational field is the gravitational potential of that point or of that location. I hope I'm correct. Work done in bringing moving unit mass from infinity to the point, use 1 kg in the definition, is maximum 1/2 out of 2. Okay, in your definition you cannot use 1 kg, you have to use unit mass. So if you use 1 kg, they're only gonna give you 1 mark out of 2. So that's important. So in a definition you should use terms, not measurements, not units. So unit mass is important, not 1 kg. Then they say that you explain why values of gravitational potential near to an isolated mass are all negative. Explain why values of gravitational potential near to an isolated mass are all negative. So it's a 3-mark question. If I was writing the answer for this question, I would write it in this manner, that at infinite distance, the gravitational force is zero, so gravitational potential is zero. Full stop, that's one sentence. As object is brought closer, gravitational field does work, slash work gets out. So negative work is done, full stop. So potential close to an isolated mass is always negative since work is done by the system. I'm going to write these 3 sentences. What they're saying in the Mars scheme, potential infinity defined as being zero, forces are always attractive. I didn't say that. So work go out in moving to point. I said that. Maximum potential at infinity allow 1/3. Okay. Maximum potential is at infinity is correct. But if someone writes that, they're only going to get 1/3. What does the examiner's report say? Very few score full marks here. Most candidates state that the potential infinity is defined as being zero. Others also state that the forces are always attractive. What was omitted was a clear statement that work is done on the mass when moving it to infinity. What was omitted was a clear statement that work is done on the mass when moving it to infinity. What? From infinity, na? Work got out in moving to point. Oh, acha. Maybe some students wrote it to that it was being moved to infinity, which was the wrong expression, but it was supposed to be that object should be moved from infinity towards the point of the gravitational field in which process the work goes out. Yeah, makes sense. Pulapan, ei point gulo ki bujhe geche? Well, I was explaining, I missed out the second point. So if I was writing the description that I just said I'd be scoring only 2/3. Because I did not say forces are always attractive. I have to say that gravitational force is always attractive. So this is the point that you need to look out for, that if you think of an answer and you write the answer on your own, please first attempt, preferably do it pencil. And then you find in your mark scheme that a certain point that you omitted, which you knew, but you didn't feel it to be important to be part of that answer, but you find it in the mark scheme, I highly recommend that you put a star mark on that point on the mark scheme, or when you are going to write your correct answer or add that point in the mark scheme, do use some notation onto that additional point that you forgot to think about in your thinking process, so that eventually when you're going to revise this worksheet, you can actually have a look that, yes, this is the point that I forgot. So I need to be careful to remember this point. This actually helps to build up a more holistic capability towards answering the questions. You might have the concept, you should have the concept, and you will have the concept right. But if you are not writing the way examiners want it to be written, then you are going to be losing mark. So it's important that you understand the concept to its core. That's important. Also, be able to write in an appropriate way the examiners prefer it is also pretty important, because you're going to be judged upon your expression. So you might have it in your belly, but if you don't express it into you through your pen, it's not worth it, at least not for the exam. Number C says the Earth may be assumed to be an accelerated sphere of radius 6.4 into the 3 km with its mass at 6.0 × 10⁴ kg, consider its center. An object is projected vertically from the surface of the Earth so that it reaches an altitude of 1.3 × 10⁴ kilometer. Important, it reaches an altitude of this much. Have a look. This is the height from the surface. Calculate for this object the change in gravitational potential. So this can be calculated by the phi expression. So I'm gonna write del phi. Can I choose a bit smaller thickness? Equals to phi final minus phi initial, which is gonna be I'm gonna write GMS common minus 1/6.4 × 10⁶ plus 1.3 × 10⁷. I'm going to write a plus over here, because I know minus and minus gives you plus. 1/6.4 × 10⁶. Have a look. What did I do? This is the final position. So what I need you to visualize that, let's say this is the Earth. The object was initially here, and then from here it was taken to here. So this is your initial distance from the center of the planet. This is your final distance. Final distance should be the addition of the radius of the Earth plus the height, altitude that is. And the initial distance should be the only radius. And because I'm trying to calculate my answer in SI unit, so I converted the kilometers into meters by simply multiplying them by 10 by 3. So this is my expression. 10⁴ is becoming 10⁷. 10�³ is becoming 10⁶. And because I know there'd be a 2 minus over here, I'm automatically giving a plus over here. You can place the value of G from the formula sheet, and the value of mass, Earth's mass, is given in kg over here. Place all these numbers and calculate this out. Everyone, help yourself. Please do this in that appropriate way in your calculator. For those who have natural history calculator, the ES calculators, ash color, you can directly write this in the fractional expression. So do write this. And the value of G is 6.67 × 10⁻³. And M is given over here, which is 6.0 × 10⁴. And whatever you get from this bracket expression. Dekho eta koto hoy, mile kina?
Four point
मिलसे
जी सर
ब्यूटीफुल So that's how you do it. So important thing is not to mess up this information. Student অনেক সময় যে কমন ভুলটা করে সেটা হচ্ছে in this expression they forget to add this up. They only subtract one by this my plus this one. You have to understand this is an altitude, very important. So this is the additional height that the isolated sphere actually moved by. So be careful to do this addition. এই ভুলটা যাতে না হয়, এটা খুব কমন মিস্টেক. Just be careful about it. Then it says the speed of the projection, the speed of the projection from our surface, assuming the air resistance is negligible. So how far should be the speed? The speed of the planet can be, speed of the object can be considered as kinetic energy, so which should be half mv squared equals to m into delta phi. Mm crosses out irrespective of the object, so projection speed should be v squared equals to something. So v should be equals to twice delta phi root over. So you just place those numbers and see how much you get. দেখো কত আসে Okay, don't write 4SF values. So try to skip, prefer to write 3SF values. If needed, prefer to use standard form. So you can write 9.15 into 10 to the power 3 or you can write 9150. Don't prefer to write 4SF values, don't. This last question is pretty simple. State why they suggest why the equation B square equals to U square plus twice S is not appropriate for the calculation in C2. Because the acceleration A is not constant. One of the very basis of applying all of the equations of motion that we've learned since our O-level is that the acceleration has to be constant for the entire scenario that we are considering. But for gravitational cases, because the distances are too large, the gravitational force, which leads up to gravitational acceleration, is not being constant. So you just write one word, A is not constant for the entire journey. That would be okay. In the answer, they have only written acceleration is not constant. So that's good. Then we have question number 3, where we have a situation of a binary star system. I'm going to help you solve it. So it's a new type of problem. Have a look. A binary star consists of two stars that orbit about a fixed point C, as shown in figure 3.1. The star of mass M1 has a circular orbit of radius R1. The star of mass M2 has a circular orbit of radius R2. Both stars have the same angular speed omega about C. So they are being attracted by each other, and that attraction is causing them to have circular motion about a fixed point. One is closer, the other one is further apart. State the formula in terms of gm1, m2, r1 and r2 and omega for the gravitational force between the two stars. So gravitational force period can be written pretty easily. This would be gm1 m2 divided by r1 plus r2 whole squared. That is the distance between them, the sum of the two radii. That's why these two should be added together and then whole squared. The centripetal force on the star of mass M1. Centripetal force on the star of mass M1. So the centripetal force should be m omega square r. So m1 omega square r1. Is it all right? Omega square. Okay, yes. Then the question says the stars orbit each other in a time of this much years. So they have already given us the second expression. So you might as well consider to write this expression directly. Calculate the angular speed omega for each star. So to be able to calculate the angular speed, it's pretty simple because the time period is given. So calculating omega is pretty simple. So omega is given by 2 pi over time period. So you can directly use this number or you can directly convert Fourier into seconds. I'm going to use this expression directly. So let's say 2 pi divided by 1.26 into 10 to the power 8. See how much you get. Now here you might have you might have, I'm not saying you should have, you might have the answer not matching. As far as I remember, the answer does some weird thing in this case. 4.99 into 10 to the power minus 8. Watt per second. So what does the masking say? Oh, it works. Beautiful. Allow 2SF of 1.59 pi. Actually, if someone doesn't multiply the pi, they're going to only score 1 out of 2. Why shouldn't someone multiply pi? Anyway, oops. It's always this dragging. Mouse wheel doesn't work for this thing. Okay. Then it says show that the ratio of the masses of the stars is given by the expression m1 by m2 equals to r2 by r1. So ratio of the masses of the stars is this. Okay, to be able to solve this, I think we just have to equate the individual centripetal force on both of the stars. If you understand that the gravitational force is this much, and which is responsible to cause the centripetal force for both of them. Magnitude wise, those two centripetal forces should be exactly equal to each other. Now, the question that you need to ask yourselves, that in most cases what happens, the point where the students actually make a mess in this question, you can see over here that m1 by m2 equals to r2 by r1 over here. Many students feel like that to get to this expression, they have to equate these two expressions. What you need to judge that if you involve these two expressions on two sides, let's say I'm going to write it over here, gm1 m2 divided by r1 plus r2 whole squared equals to m1 omega square r1. If you write this expression, naturally your m1 is getting crossed out, so you don't have your m1 in your equation. Or if you write m2 in terms of m2, this one, your m2s go out, so you're not going to have both of these m's in this equation. That's problem number one. Problem number two, in that in this expression you have this thing, r1 plus r2 whole squared, but for this part you don't need that. You don't have that in your right side. So basically speaking, involving this expression of gravitational force might not be a good idea to get to this point. So what would be a good idea? A good idea would be to write the centripetal force expression for both of them. So m1 omega square r1 should be equals to m2 omega square r2. That expression by default converts into this. Omega square crosses out, and you just change sides and you get this. That's a two-mark equation. So that's how you should think. And don't write an expression and get stuck within that part. That's important. Just try to look a bit forward in your working so that you can have some additional benefits in your working procedure. In question number two, it says the ratio of m1 by m2 is equal to 3.0 and the separation of the stars is this. Have a look. This is called separation, which means this is actually the total sum of r1 plus r2. Read these words very carefully. This is this much. Calculate the radii of r1 and r2. Now, we have this expression that m1 by m2 is equal to r2 by r1. So we, in this expression, now can go ahead and use that initial expression. So what can I write? M1 by M2 equals to 3.0, which means R2 by R1 equals to 3.0, which leads to R2 plus R1 divided by R1 equals to 4.0 divided by 1. Do you understand what I did over here? Bolovan, a mathematical operation to bujo. I just added plus 1 on both sides. Intentionally. Why? Because I wanted to have R2 plus R1 as my numerator. You do the LCM, so you get this. I simply could have skipped writing this bottom 0 over here, bottom 1 over here, I was just trying to show this in a form of equation, so that's why. So you can write this one, and that can lead up to this, that 3.2 into 10 to the power 11 divided by R1 equals to 4.0. So R1 should be equals to 4 atabotrish, so 8.0 into 10 to the power 10. That is your R1 value, and then you could then to calculate the value of R2, you can either go for the ratio expression, you can either go for the subtraction, do whatever you please, and then you add that value. So if this is 8.0, I can pretty well say that R2 should be equals to 3 times that, so that is 2.4 into 10 to the power 10 meters. So these are two numbers you have to write. It is a 2-mark expression over here because the math is supposed to be very simple. So that shouldn't be very difficult to achieve. In option 2, D says, by equating the expressions you have given in A and using the data calculated in B and C, determine the mass of one of the stars. So now you are expected to use that expression that you wrote over here and use it to calculate the mass of any one of the stars. So M1 or M2 doesn't matter. So if you equate these two, M1 will cancel out, so you're gonna have the value of M2. So let's just try to do that, and then we're gonna try to solve this one. So if I just write this expression, that G M1 M2 divided by R1 plus R2 whole squared equals to M1 omega square R1. So M1 crosses out. If you are trying, we want to find out the value of M2. Subjecting that, M2 equals to omega square R1 multiplied by R1 plus R2 whole squared divided by G. So এখানে ভ্যালু গুলো বসাও বসায় দেখো কত আসে এনতে একটা ভ্যালু আসবে এখন কথা হচ্ছে এরপর যে কোশ্চেন আসবে whether the answer in 1 is for the more massive or the less massive star. Now this is a very question, this is a question that in many cases I have to answer multiple times for the kids, but hear me out on this one. This is a very simple question to answer. Have a look at this thing. M1 by M2 equals to 3.0. So if you just look at this expression, which one is the massive star? Which M is big?
M1.
M1 is big. So if you did calculate M1 in this equation, you're gonna write M be massive, more massive. Because I calculate M2, I'm simply going to write less massive. I'm going to write these two words over here. I don't have to mention any reason because this is just only a state question. So you just write less massive and you score this mark. That's it. Just consider the expression of the mass ratio and then you're good. There are a lot of equation involved, and tomorrow for the time equation jhara mugusto kora lagbe na equation gulo ami je ajke class e shurute je rokom ek jaygay the likhe nechilam kothay jano je ekdom shurute onek gulo equation likhe liklam na ei je ekhane gelo ei je ekta equation likhe nechilam erokom tumi equation gulo ekta certain jaygay likhe nite paro je kon ta kisher equation, and then you can keep on using those equation by looking at that chart that you make yourself to solve the questions, no problem. দেখে ইউজ করতে করতে আস্তে আস্তে তোমাদের মাথায় যেগুলো ঢোকা সেগুলো মাথায় ঢুকে যাবে ঠিক আছে জাস্ট ট্রাই মানে এভরি সিঙ্গেল টাইম ইউ আর অ্যাবাউট টু রাইট রাইট ইউজ অ্যান ইকুয়েশন জাস্ট ট্রাই টু রিমেম্বার ফ্রম ইওর হেড ইফ ইউ ক্যান রিমেম্বার ইট টেক হেল্প ফ্রম দ্য লিস্ট সো উইদিন দ্যাট অ্যাটেম্প্ট অফ ইয়ার্স ইয়োর ব্রেন ইজ গোনা স্লোলি ক্যাপচার দ্য ইকুয়েশনস অ্যাজ ইউ আর গোনা কিপ অন সলভিং দ্য ওয়ার্কশিট সো ওটা নিয়ে আলাদা এফোর্ট দেওয়ার দরকার নেই অ্যান্ড খুব বেশি টেনশন করার প্রয়োজন নাই আচ্ছা এরপরে কোশ্চেনটা অ্যাকচুয়ালি খুব একটা ঝামেলা না আমি আরেকটা কোশ্চেন সলভ করে তোমাদের ক্লাস ছেড়ে দিচ্ছি 10:30 অলমোস্ট বাজে আচ্ছা এটা আমরা অ্যাকচুয়ালি ডেরিভেশন দেখাইছিলাম সো এটা ওইখান থেকে ডাইরেক্টলি ইকুয়েশন ইকুয়াল করে দেখাইলে হবে আচ্ছা এটা অ্যাকচুয়ালি আমি এই কোশ্চেনটা করে দেখাই এই কোশ্চেনটাতে কিছু পলিটিক্যাল জিনিসপত্র আছে দেখো বলবান That may be considered to be a minimum sphere of mass m, considered a center, a satellite of mass m orbits the Earth such that the radius of the particle orbit is r. So the linear speed v of the satellite is given by the expression v equals to rho g m by r. This is very simple. You simply write the gravitational force is equal to centripetal force and ultimately that will lead to this expression. Then it says for the satellite, write down the expressions in terms of g, m, m, and r for its kinetic energy. So kinetic energy expression as well. Half m into gm by r, because it is a square korle this gives us what v square equals to gm by r. So eta hobe hocche amader kinetic energy expression. Calculate its expression for the gravitational potential energy. Now you have to understand that this has a circular orbit of r. Gravitational potential energy is given by what? Gravitational potential energy is given by m into delta phi. Now, in this case, we are trying to find out the absolute gravitational potential of an object. So we have to consider that if this was the planet and we are trying to set up the satellite over here, we are trying to find out the gravitational potential of this exact point. So we have to consider that what if this satellite was brought from the infinite distance, figure not drawn to scale, to this point, how much energy should have been utilized? That's the expression for gravitational potential energy. So initial position should be infinite distance, final position should be at r distance from the planet. So this is going to be working like this. This is m into delta phi, which is equals to m into 0 minus minus gm by r. So this would be minus gmm by r, but this one was actually half gmm by r. So the total energy should be the sum of these two. So if we just add these two numbers, this is gonna be r, my bad. So total energy is gonna be half. This is the positive value, gmm by r plus minus gmm by r. So you are still left with a minus half gmm by r. This minus sign is actually pretty important because we're going to have to answer some questions regarding this expression on the right side. So I'm going to keep this thing in view and let's have a look at these questions. So I'm going to keep this expression in view. Have a look at C. The total energy of the satellite gradually decreases. Understand, the total energy of the satellite gradually decreases. Can you explain this effect, the effect of this decrease on the radius r of the orbit? If the total energy value decreases, what should happen to r? Now think about it. If the total energy, you can see that the total energy is already a negative value. If it decreases from this number, does it become more negative or less negative? Think. Ask the question again, at least for the people who are still here in the channel. The total energy of the planet decreases. We have calculated in the expression that the total energy of the planet is a negative value, a negative number. If it decreases from a negative number, does it become more negative or does it become less negative?
More negative.
It should definitely become more negative. Think about it. If I ask you that a number is minus 4, it decreases, what should it become? Should it become go in the direction of minus 5, minus 6? Should it go become minus 3, minus 2? It should definitely become more negative because it is supposed to become smaller. So if this number becomes more negative, the value of this expression should become larger. Now you have to understand that g is a constant, capital M is a constant, small m is also a constant. So if this expression has to become larger to make the number more negative, what should happen to r? The denominator should become smaller or larger? I'll say the question again. Try to understand it. This number is going to get converted into a more negative number, which means the magnitude of this number is going to increase. The magnitude of this number is simply expressed by, let's say, this expression, gmm by r. This is the magnitude of this value. This is supposed to become larger. And you can see that these three things, g, capital M, and small m, these three things are pretty much constant for this case. So what should happen to R if the value has to go up? This is a fraction. To increase the value of the fraction, should the denominator become smaller or larger? It should become smaller.
Yes.
So that's how you decide. So state and explain the effect on this decrease zone. So this is a 2-mark question. The first I'm going to write radius of the orbit R of the orbit decreases, full stop. Writing that expression scores you 1 mark. And then I'm going to write the total energy is a negative number. Decreasing the total energy means the magnitude of total energy will increase, which is possible if the denominator, comma, R becomes smaller. That will be my expression. Perfectly mathematical. Exactly what I just said over here, explained over here, I'm going to write that into words. I'm going to look in the Marsh scheme to see what the examiners have to say. This is for question number 5C. It says, if ET, they're using this expression to represent total energy, it decreases, then minus GM by GMM by 2R becomes more negative, or GMM by 2R becomes larger. So you can either write either of these expressions. So R decreases. So totally a mathematical expression works. The linear speed V of the satellite. What happens to the linear speed V of the satellite? So V is given by root over GM by R. So if you say over here, R becomes smaller, so what should happen to V? Think.
Increases.
It definitely increases. A question, most of the cases is a problem. In many cases, students mess up this question. They write the wrong answer over here. And if they state it wrong, the explanation is going to be wrong anyway. So they might lose this number altogether. But if they write this answer corresponding to this expression, for example, someone writes over here that the radius should increase. And then they write over here the linear speed should decrease because R increase would mean that they're going to get full marks for number two, because that's what we call ECF. They made a mess up over here, which lead to a wrong answer over here. But this answer is congruent or agreeing with what they mentioned over here. They might actually score full marks for number two, even though it's a wrong answer, but it is correct to their construct. It is correct within their understanding. So that can happen. But I hope you don't do that. I hope you score total 2+2, 4 marks on this question. Any questions so far?
Yes, sir.
Gotcha. Ask you to talk. Inshallah, my next class, I'll try to take a book. Toma Judy Paro, a worksheet, take a problem, try to go. I'm not choosing any specific problem for you. Just try, let's say, the even number problems. Maybe you have only Tuesday, tomorrow, or Kal Tapro. I'm the witness in the class, which is actor ticket, right? Jesus.
Beautiful.
আমি গত ওয়েডনেসডে অ্যাকচুয়ালি এইচ ট্যাঙ্গে ব্যাক করতেছিলাম, ভেঙে ভেঙে আসতে হয়েছে, সো ইট ওয়াজ এ বিট মেসড আপ সিচুয়েশন, সো জন্য গত ওয়েডনেসডে ক্লাস হয়নি। এই ওয়েডনেসডে ইনশাআল্লাহ অবশ্যই ক্লাস নেব, সো আই এম নট গোনা মিস দ্যাট। থ্যাংক ইউ ভেরি মাচ, থ্যাঙ্কস ফর দ্য পেশেন্স, গুড নাইট, আসসালামু আলাইকুম।